So today's lecture is on headache and not on facial pain. It was initially facial pain, but then this lecture is like 3 hours, so I decided to do it in 1 hour, and we'll do next tomorrow, we'll do another lecture. All right. So headaches and facial pain. How many people suffer here from migraines? Only one? You don't have migraines? Wow, that's very low prevalence. Okay. Probably that's why you're doctors. Okay, anybody has tension headaches? Or ever had tension headaches?
I have one right now.
Okay, all right. Cluster headache sufferers? Cluster headache? No. So that's pretty much what the population is, actually. So we define a headache as a pain in the head that's located above the eyes and ears and behind the head in the occipital region. And back of the upper neck, we also consider it as a headache. Everything here in the face, we call it facial pain per definition. So if you have to define and put the right name in the impression, then it has to be facial pain. And then you have to work for the differential diagnosis of the facial pain. This is the pointer, yeah. So we divide headaches in primary and secondary, and it's basically based on in some pathologies in the brain. And whenever you see a patient for the first time with a headache, presenting with a headache, and someone that has been having headaches for years, you always have to think of secondary causes, because you can meet sometimes there are some mimickers of migraine among patients with brain tumors. So, and then you realize that it's a brain tumor, and if you send the patient to the neurosurgeon and it's operable, then the patient doesn't have migraine headache anymore. Now, in this lecture, we're going to talk about classification because it's very important. It's a basis for diagnosis. And a little bit on pathophysiology, differential diagnosis, and pharmacotherapy. So this is the first study, actually, population-based study done in Denmark by one of my colleagues. And she basically looked into the general population and found that approximately 74% at some point in their life, within the past year, complained, actually this is 1 year prevalence, complained of headache, which was classified as tension type headache. 10% were having migraines, and less than 1% cluster headache. In US, the number is around anywhere between 8 and 18, right? Sure. I think it's like 12% generally. So it's not very different from Danish population. Now, we consider migraine as a chronic disorder with episodic manifestations. It's sometimes mistaken for sinuses, and you see the patients in the clinic, they say, I have sinus headaches. And if you take a little bit more history, and you'll find out that they have migraine headache. It's also diagnosed with exclusion, again, it can be episodic or chronic based on the frequency, which is very important now because we have a wonderful drug, Botox. Dr. Lopez loved it because he used it a lot. And you need to actually know the diagnosis of chronic migraine in order to find the patients eligible for the Botox injections. So this is basically a very important slide because this gives you the the criteria for migraine, which you need to have in order to diagnose the patients for migraine. So it's a headache which lasts anywhere from 4 hours to 72 hours untreated, okay? Now, some patients can have headaches for 5 days. So again, it's not a strict criteria. These are all made by humans, this criteria, by people, by some headache gurus. And based on the studies, we show that in general, patients are having headaches anywhere from 4 to 72 hours. And believe it or not, insurance companies actually are asking for these numbers when they are finding the eligibility criteria for some treatments and all those things. Now, then you need to have at least two of this following criteria. So it's unilateral location, pulsating quality, moderate or severe intensity, or aggravation by routine physical activities. Whenever patients tell you, I have a very severe headache, always think of migraine. Actually, in some population studies we have done, we have sent the questionnaires when we asked them, have you ever suffered from severe headache in your life? And then we found, actually, that majority of these people were having migraines. And migraine headache can be also bilateral, so don't think of just unilateral headache. And you know how many percent of migraineurs can have bilateral headache, or approximately? Actually, higher, up to 40. Yeah. And it's usually aggravated by physical activities. They'll tell you the headache gets worse by movement or by various other activities, which involves insertion. Now, you need to have at least one of the following criteria: nausea, vomiting, or photophobia and phonophobia, which is very classic for migraine headache. Now, we divide it in episodic and chronic, and it's basically, it helps you to figure out if the patient are eligible for some treatment or are they eligible for preventive therapies. Now, this is a lot, and it's becoming disabling, the headache, if they have it on 15 days or more. You need to have at least 50. These are classification criteria which has been revised, and in 2006 they sat down and again revised them and found that this is probably the best way of classifying chronic migraine. So you need to have at least 15 days of headache per month over the past 3 months, and eight of them has to be with migraine features, pure migraine features. Then you can give them diagnosis of chronic migraine. And that's what Jessica comes, you know, and always tells you about, give the Botox to the patients. And they need to have basically this criteria. Now, this is the worst case scenario, basically, in the patient's life, right? And it occurs in 2 or 3% of population. And when the migraine becomes from chronic and it transforms from episodic to chronic, basically, you'll see it a lot in clinic when patients come and tell you, like, my headaches were, like, I had like 2 or 3 attacks per month, and now I have like 15 or 20 days. So, and they'll tell you usually they gradually evolve into this pattern of chronic migraine. It's called migraine transformation. Okay, so when you talk about migraine, and you know, we do the pain here, we always think of pain, right? Pain, 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 treat the pain. Migraine is actually more complex. It's not just the pain. And some of the symptoms can be as disabling as pain and need to be treated, actually. Now, if the patient has a migraine, there is a sort of threshold for this migraine. Now, there must be some triggers to kind of trigger this migraine attack, right? And if you have enough triggers, then you will start, the migraine attack may start. Now, lately we found that some patients, more than 40% of patients, actually it's even more probably, but 40% who report, people report some symptoms before the migraines, days or hours before, like, you know, feeling tired, depressed, hungry sometimes, or sometimes loss of appetite. So various kind of symptoms which we think come from hypothalamus, like, you know, like which may be connected to the pain phase. We don't know for sure yet. We're trying to actually explore these mechanisms now, but this is the fact, they have it. And you can ask the patient if they have any warning signs, and they will tell you about the symptoms. Then what happens is that some people get auras, right? And we'll talk about auras in a little bit. And then there comes the pain phase, the headache phase, which can last anywhere from 4 to 72 hours. And afterwards, what we have is we have improvement phase. Migraineurs will tell you, you know, I feel tired, exhausted after my attack, you know. Could it be due to medication? You know, sometimes they take medication, it can cause this kind of tiredness. Yes, it can, but these symptoms usually mimic the symptoms of premonitory phase. And then we have the improvement end of the improvement and end of the attack. So this is actually, you see, the pain is actually 1/4 of the migraine syndrome or complex. Now, another very important classification or division of migraine is migraine with aura and without aura. It has a lot of clinical implications, and 2/3 of patients, majority of patients, has migraine with aura or common migraine, you know, previously called common migraine. And 1/3 will have migraine with aura, and in 5% it coexists. Okay? Now, what is aura? Aura, these are reversible neurologic symptoms which can involve visual cortex, so they can be visual symptoms, they can be sensory symptoms, or speech disturbances. And you need at least two of the following. They have to be unilateral usually, and they have to gradually develop. So you will see the patient will tell you the spot is initially small, and then it becomes bigger and bigger in size over an hour. It could be 30 minutes, you know, it's different from patient to patient, but it has to be more than five minutes, and each symptoms last anywhere from more than 3 to to less than an hour. Now, if the patient comes with the aura which lasts 1 hour or more, you will think of stroke. You know, you have to work out for the stroke and all those things, and maybe send to a neurologist if you're a pain specialist. You see this pins and needle sensation, numbness. These are positive symptoms, these are negative symptoms. Positive symptoms, you know, negative symptoms. I had a patient who had loss of vision. She was in the subway, completely loss of vision for 2 minutes. And, you know, she had to sit down and then, you know, she was freaking out, you know, she was afraid of what was going on. And before she had some flickering lights, but now she developed this new loss of vision symptom. And of course, you know, I ordered appropriate imaging studies to work up for stroke and all other secondary causes. This is actually the description of aura by a physician in 1870. You see, it starts as a as a little spot which can be blurry or black, and it slowly becomes more a kind of form. We call this pattern fortification spectrum because it looks like it's a fort. And sometimes this area can be actually blurry or dark. It's quite disabling. You can imagine a patient driving in a car and having this. And some people have them so much so they actually complain of this more than pain. And they say pain is like nothing. This is more for me than pain. This is another slide showing the classical development of aura. It starts usually in the fingers and slowly goes up and involves the whole arm. Now, if a patient has a stroke, like TIA, they usually have the whole arm involvement at the same time. Here, we call it marching symptoms. They start and slowly, gradually increase in their, basically increase in their spatial location. And this is basically, you see here in the eyes, it's smaller and becomes bigger and bigger and bigger at the same time. This has a lot of implication, actually. If you have a female patient who has migraine with aura and uses oral contraceptive pills and smokes, her risk for stroke is increased 3 times compared to general population. And it has to be in your chart, you have to actually document that. You told the patient to stop, you know, to stop smoking cessation, and you had to speak to a gynecologist about using the oral contraceptive pills. And I think this comes on the boards also, this question. Now, this is a classical presentation, 90% of the population. Aura symptoms, you know, between five minutes to one hour. Then there is a free interval, like less than 5 minutes, and then there is a headache phase. In 4%, however, the aura can actually overlap. And we see sometimes the aura occurring during the migraine headaches. And most of the time, if you have a chronic migraineurs, like 70% of my patients, they can have auras within the headache attack because, you know, they have continuous headaches. And they get exacerbations on the top of this continuous headaches. And they can have the auras like within their migraines. And in very small proportion of patients, we have symptoms with just auras without the migraine phase. They have maybe had migraines before with auras, and now it's pure aura. And usually they're anywhere between 45 and 55, like an average. And when they come to emergency room, it's always they consider like in TIA or, you know, a stroke, and then, you know, you get all imaging studies, everything is negative. And now in classification, we have actual diagnosis of migraine with aura without the headache phase. But this is, again, this is very few. Most of the people you'll see is here in the clinics. Now, this is the question we get a lot from, you know, people. What is the pathophysiology? Why people get migraines? We don't know for sure, actually, where migraine starts. We don't know what this migraine generator is. It could be in the brainstem, it could be in the vessels, or it could be in the cortex. But we know there are certain structures which are involved in migraine, and hypothalamus is one of them. And thalamus, of course, because it receives all input, sensory input. Brainstem with all this periaqueductal gray matter, and which modulates the pain. And also the trigeminal spinal nucleus, which is very important in perception of the pain from the face. And nociceptors, which are basically perivascular. Because we know the brain is not sensitive, actually. There's no nociceptors in the brain matter itself, parenchyma. So everything with the pain we perceive from the head is either comes from the skin or muscles, or it can come from the perivascular nociceptors or dura, because dura is very sensitive for pain. Now, another very important phenomenon called cortical spectrum depression has been shown to be probably related to initiation of migraine attack. Now, there are some studies which support, some studies against. This is basically what happens. In the occipital cortex, there is a start of depolarization of neurons, and they connect it through the gap junctions and through the other connections, like dendrites. And what happens is when there is depolarization, it's like a wave of depolarization. It starts in the occipital cortex and goes slowly over to the parietal cortex, which is involved with the sensory function. And that's where you actually have the aura symptoms. That's why you get the symptoms of flickering lights and then the numbness sensation. So it's mediated by here. Now, we know actually that migraine starts in the vessels, right? If it starts in the vessels, there is definitely pain component here in the peripheral nerve, first order neuron. They dilate usually, there is a leakage of neuropeptides, they irritate the nerve endings, and then they basically synthesize the second order neuron, and this way you can get pain. Now since we found that aura is, let me just see here. Now, this is cortical spectrum depression. I just mentioned to you before, right? So we think that cortical spectrum depression actually can activate trigeminal vascular nervous system. And by doing this, actually, what happens is that when the trigeminal vascular nervous system is activated, there is a continuous nociceptive processing going all the way to the trigeminal ganglion, and from there to the second order neuron in the brainstem here, and from there the nociception is transmitted to the thalamus, and from thalamus to the cortex, and you feel the pain. That's how we think it's happening. Okay, so enough on migraine. We'll talk about the treatment of migraine after I talk about tension type headache and cluster headache. Now, tension type headache is the most common headache. We don't see it much in the clinics because it's less disabling when it comes to an episodic. When it becomes chronic, then it's disabling, then we see it. And then we think sometimes it's migraine, we treat them as a migraine, unfortunately. But it's not correct, actually, I have to treat it differently. Tension type headache before was called muscle contraction, tension headache. All the studies we have done, which are negative, and I was a subject on one of the studies, actually I had a dialysis, microdialysis catheter placed in my trapezius muscle. All results were negative, so there's no muscle pathology. It's probably more a condition intrinsic to the brain, just like fibromyalgia, which we also thought this was muscle pain, but it's more, and muscle pain is now a secondary phenomenon. And here we divide tension headache in episodic and chronic, just like with migraine. The headache is usually bilateral, it's pressing, it's mild to moderate, and it can be with muscle tenderness or without muscle tenderness. Now again, we don't see these patients much because in this system where the patient has to pay copays, they don't want to come and pay copays for this headache. But in the system where they're socialized, where I worked in Denmark, for example, a lot of patients will come to the office and they will be treated. And actually, for some reason, it was not very well built in US, and now it's part of actually billing system, so you can actually quote for tension type headache. Now this is a slide that illustrates the pathophysiology. So we think still the input comes from the muscle, at the peripheral nociceptors. Now in muscle, actually, if you dissect the muscle, you would not find the nociceptors in the muscle tissue itself. Studies from Germany, from a group in Heidelberg, actually showed that the nociception comes from the from the vessels in the muscles, actually. So they're perivascular. And what happens is there is probably a release of neuropeptides from the vessels because, they get dilated. And when they get dilated, at this release of neuropeptides, they can be irritating for the nerve endings. They send the irritated nerves, the peripheral nociceptors, and the pain transmission is started and going all the way to the second order neuron. And here, actually shown by my elder brother, if you give nitric oxide inhibitors, you can actually stop the headache attack. And it's actually a possible novel, basically, area where we can actually develop the new drugs by developing nitric oxide inhibitors for this type of headache. It's actually shown for migraines as well. You can induce migraine attack by giving the nitric oxide intravenously, by giving nitroglycerin. Now, this is an important slide to show what is the difference between tension-type headache and migraine. And the reason is this implication for the treatments, because treatments for migraine can be different than the treatments for tension-type headache. So, again, it's a headache which affects more females. Both of them affect more females. I mean, for some reason, females are affected more by headaches, probably hormonal component. The age is pretty much the same, the age of onset. Of course, there is aura for migraine. If you see the patient with auras, it's never tension-type headache. It's always migraine. Localization usually unilateral, you know, tension-type headache is usually bilateral. Migraine is usually throbbing or pulsating. Tension-type headache is pressing. And of course, associated symptoms, which are not quite typical for tension-type headache. And the other thing is that sometimes we see like hormones play major, more role in migraine than in tension-type headache. During pregnancy, headaches can get better, which I cannot recommend to patients, but it's one of the kind of alleviating factors for migraine. Now, the cluster headache. This is, in my opinion, one of the interesting headache syndromes. Very dramatic, and a lot of times, now Scott is not here, ER physicians get scared when they see the presentation because it can be a very dramatic, objective presentation. Perhaps it's the most severe pain condition known to humans, and typically the pain is in the V1 distribution, and usually retroorbital. It's a brief episode of pain, and it's usually kind of boring, kind of stabbing pain, and occurred during the periods. That's why it's called cluster. And there's dramatic autonomic features, and there is always, not always, but maybe most of the time, restlessness and agitation. They will tell you they actually pace, you know, and it helps their headache attacks compared to migraineurs, rather be in a dark, quiet room and not move. You're smiling. Do you have a cluster headache attack or no? I've seen some doctors actually with this cluster headache attacks, which is, and some of them are on opioids, so, which I'm not agree. I don't agree with this. So cluster headache attacks. Now, this is a classification. That's how you define them. That's how you need to have at least 5 attacks. They need to last at least 15 to 180 minutes, and you need to have at least one of these criteria. And this is the real patient having cluster headache attack. You see there's a ptosis, there's a little bit of eyelid edema, and he has a tearing of his eye, redness. You don't see really pupil here, but it's actually small. This is a quite typical presentation. So the patient will get the attacks sometimes during the fall or springtime, usually. And they will last anywhere from 7 days to 1 year. And then there is remission period for over than 1 month. This is episodic pattern. In less than 10% of cluster headache patients, that's even much less in population, they can become chronic and can be very disabling. Very hard to treat. We don't know what to do for these patients. Right now, they're developing a device which can be implanted here, and it works on the sphenopalatine ganglion, which is involved in pathophysiology, I'll show you later. And this device actually has been shown to be effective. And now there's some trials in Europe. FDA has not approved it yet for trials even here. So we're waiting for the approval. And as soon as they approve it, we'll go enroll the patients with a chronic cluster headache to the study. Pathophysiologically, the positron emission studies have shown that there are several areas which are activated in the brain during the attack. But most important area which consistently has been activated in all studies is the posterior hypothalamus. How this is implicated, we don't know for sure. But this is a diagram showing that these are the structures which are involved. Now, in lacrimation, there is this parasympathetic pathways, sympathetic pathways here, trigeminal pathways. This is the brainstem with all the structures which might be involved. And hypothalamus and thalamus. It's a very complex pain condition, unfortunately not very well studied, and the reason, one of the reasons is we don't have money to study this headache. Insurance companies are not interested, the pharmaceutical companies are not interested in developing drugs for this condition because it's less than 1% of the population. So everything we get is from the government, but right now we don't have much money. So unfortunately this is not a very well studied headache, but very disabling. Now when we talk about cluster headache, we always talk about trigeminal autonomic cephalalgias because this is a group of headache conditions which are very rare but involve autonomic features, and cluster headache is one of them. The two other important diagnoses are paroxysmal hemicrania and Sait. Now, the difference between these three types of headaches is actually in duration of their attacks. Now, for Sait, the durations are usually anywhere from 5 seconds to 4 minutes, and people can have up to 200 attacks per day. And here, they can have up to 40 attacks, you know, anywhere from 8 to 40 attacks. And cluster headaches usually 1 to 3 attacks, most occurring at night. And you see this is duration, this is like a spectrum of time. Another important slide is to differentiate between trigeminal neuralgia and cluster headache. Comes on the boards also. So basically the difference is the quality of the pain usually, and also the localization. V1, V2 distribution here. V2, V3 distribution here, V1 distribution here. And also associated symptoms, autonomic symptoms, never with trigeminal neuralgia. And the duration, it's here is like few seconds, electric shock-like. Here it can be up to 3 hours sometimes. Okay, now the treatment. Treatment of migraine attack is basically you can give anything, all analgesic to migraineurs, but we do have some effective treatments, because in the beginning of 90s, actually late 80s, triptans have been developed and revolutionized the migraine research, and now we can give these medications. Now, if you practice in evidence-based medicine, then you have to start with aspirin, metoclopramide, and go slowly towards this. If you don't practice evidence-based medicine, you start here. And when I see the patients, they already tried this, so I usually start here. So, so we divide the treatment in disease non-specific and disease specific. These are specific medication which developed for migraine. Yes.
Why does Regnan work?
So Regnan is a dopamine reduction dopamine receptors. Now, Regnan is an anti-nausea medication. We have shown that if you treat the nausea in migraineurs, sometimes the pain can actually get better. You have probably heard that sometimes migraineurs actually will do, what they will do if they have a severe nausea and have a headache, they will try to vomit, and the headaches get better actually after they vomit.
If they don't have nausea, do you give it anyway?
You can give it, because in IV especially, in emergency room, because it has also antinociceptive properties. That's why. And it's used a lot we use it a lot too, but used a lot by other physicians in emergency rooms, for example. I sometimes give Compazine to people also, which is also another. Zofran helps. It has, anecdotally, it should help migraine too, because it has anti-serotonin properties. It works on the HT2 receptors, but it's very the potency of the drug is very low compared to all others, so that's why we don't use it. And it's insurance companies don't approve it, so it's very hard to get Zofran approved unless the patient has cancer pain or cancer condition, and getting Zofran for. Now we use analgesics, non-steroidals as non-specific, and opioids. And opioids are in gray because I personally don't use a lot of opioids. We have some patients who come, and sometimes nothing helps, literally. And they have to be on opioids, but it's a very small proportion, in my opinion, 10% of chronic migraineurs, which is 1 to 3% of the population. So you see it's, and you will see sometimes the headache specialist start patients, and then they send them to the pain specialist, because they don't want to deal with opioids. That's what happens most of the time. These are the dosages and medications. Basically, it's based on randomized, placebo-controlled studies. We use Cambia. We love the Cambia, right? And K1 loves it too. And naproxen can be used because it's longer-acting, non-steroidal. These are the older medications for migraine, Cafergot and Migranil. Since we have triptans, we use them less. But they're very effective, actually. And if the patient do not respond to triptans, you can try this. And Cafergot has ergotamine and caffeine. Right now, you can buy pure ergotamine medication in the United States. You can buy it in some other countries, but not in the U.S. And Migranil is a nasal spray. And there is a study which has been shown for inhalers of DHE, and they're coming soon also on market. I think they filed for FDA now this year, right? Yeah. So probably next year we're going to have more of the talks on inhalers and So triptans. These are the most effective medications for migraines, and this is like basically a gift for patients. There are 9 available in the U.S. 9 triptans. They are very efficient, and there are few side effects compared to Cafergot and DHE. Unfortunately, there are some disadvantages. You cannot prescribe them to patients with heart disease because of the vasoconstriction, and there is recurrence from anywhere from 20% to 40%, and the price, they can be expensive. Now, the contraindications is uncontrolled hypertension, ischemic heart disease, vasculopathies, pregnancy, basal or hemiplegic migraine. It's contraindicated, okay, if the patient has a hemiplegic migraine. Hemiplegic migraine was initially thought as a migraine with aura. Now it's a separate condition when the patient gets a weakness, literally like a stroke-like weakness in their arm, which actually resolve. And this headaches has recently been shown maybe is even different in pathophysiology from other types of migraine. And basilar type, if they get like dizziness or vertiginous symptoms, the basilar, it's a controversial diagnosis. We don't know. I mean, there's a lot of debate around this diagnosis. But if the patient have any of those, don't prescribe, because I have seen people getting prescribed and coming to me, and thanks God they didn't develop strokes or heart attacks or anything. Warning signs, co-administration with Mayos and SSRIs. You know, be careful when you prescribe SSRIs. It's not a contraindication, but it's something that you need to be aware of. That can get serotonin syndrome, and you don't want that. Side effects, always, patient, not always, majority of time the patient will tell you tightness and heaviness. And you just need to warn the patient about the symptoms, because sometimes if they try this and they say, oh no, I'm not going to take this anymore. But if it only lasts like 5 minutes and the headache is gone, I would still prescribe this medications. Paresthesia, sensational warm, fatigue. This can be a problem for like patients who work if they take the medication at work. This is the mechanism of action. So they sometimes work in the vessels. When they developed, they were initially thought to work on the vessels, but now they work also on the at the second order neurons in the brainstem. So basically, there are different formulations. There's a PO, there is nasal sprays, and subcutaneous formulation. In Europe, there are suppositories too. And the choice is basically, if the patient has a lot of nausea, cannot, is vomiting all the time, probably subcutaneous or nasal spray is the best. And again, early treatment is, as soon as they get a headache attack, they should use it. Studies have shown that if you use it earlier, the better. Because you prevent central sensitization, you prevent the recurrence of the attacks. And you can combine it with other agents. So there is a drug called Trexamet. It's a combination of sumatriptan and naproxen. And the hypothesis is by giving the sumatriptan, you treat the actual attack. And what you do is you prevent recurrence by giving the non-steroidal. But what you can do is, like, if you have a very nice glue, you can take naproxen and put it together with the Imitrex and give it to your grandmother or your significant other to treat the migraine attacks. So, and save some money. Okay? Well, the company says naproxen is working faster there. You know, they have some pharmacokinetic data. Now, preventive treatment, when to consider it. There is no really standard, yes?
Do you prescribe that new toward, like,
I would. I mean, it's off-label, of course, but because toradol is, what is it? It's non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug. And actually, IV toradol has been shown to be very effective for migraines, like people presenting with migraines in the emergency room. Like yesterday, I had a patient in the clinic, and she was like complaining of Ms. Hurwitz. She came to see me. Yeah. And she came to see me again because she had, again, migraine. I gave her toradol, shot of toradol. Intramuscularly, but you can give nasal spray too if you want. Yeah, you can experiment do this combination of non-steroidals. We're talking about the patients which are not just responding to triptans. Ideally, the patient takes triptans and goes away, We're talking about the patients, like, you know, 1 or 2% of the population who has difficult migraines, headaches, and then you can combine them with non-steroidals. Now, what are the indications? Now, U.S. Headache Consortium, which is American Headache Society and American, what is it, Primary Care Physician Society, whatever, they basically decided what to do, what are the indications for preventive therapies, you know? And one of the indications is recurring migraines. And if they are interfering with their daily routines, they're disabling. If they're frequent, if they're more than three times a month. If there are contraindication to other therapies, if they're using too much of their abortive medications, which is not good. And adverse events with acute therapies. Cost of the acute therapies. Patients, sometimes patients say, I want to be in preventive because I have many headaches and I don't want it. I want it. Give it to me, Dr. Lopez. And give me some opioids. And you'll say, no, I'll first give you preventive medication, and then you will use opioids only. First, then you will use Imitrex or similar medications, and then if nothing helps, then we'll go to opioids, okay? And of course, if the patient has hemiplegic migraine, too many auras, you know, you can use the preventive therapies as well. These are the medications used for migraine prevention. One of the major group is beta blockers. We use them a lot, and they're proven in randomized control studies, used for years. Propranolol is one of them. You can use nadolol, atenolol, metoprolol as well. Tofenamic acid is a non-steroidal which can be used at 300 milligrams daily, not available in the U.S., only in Canada and Europe. Lisinopril is available, can be used also, been shown in small studies, one or two studies. And the same is for this ARP2 antagonist. It's cadensartan or atacant. I use it sometimes in the patients. Antiepileptic drugs, topiramate, valproic acid, used a lot. I mean, it's like one of those frequently prescribed. I'll show it in the next slide. There's calcium channel blockers and, of course, TCAs. These are the dosages, basically. Propranolol, you can start with 40, go up to 120. I mean, these are relative dosages. You can go higher up if you want. Anticonvulsants, Topamax, you start with 25 daily for 1 week and then increase by 25 each week to the a maximum of 50 twice a day. You can go higher up, but then the patient can get cognitive side effects. The most common side effects of Topamax is paresthesias because of low potassium. You tell the patients to eat foods rich in potassium, and then they can, like orange juice, bananas. They can get weight loss. They love it, 30%. It's like, as soon as they hear the side effects, they want to be on this medication. And the other thing is they can get nephrolithiasis. They don't like the side effects. If the patient has kidney stones, history, they're at risk for development of the kidney stones. And patients actually can develop de novo kidney stones on top of Max. So you need to tell them to drink a lot of fluids when they're on it. And another thing with Topamax is people can get actually cognitive problems. Like one of our chairmen in a neurology department at Montefiore, who lives in Greenwich, Connecticut, his wife was calling him one day and she was on Topamax and she was telling him that she doesn't know where she is and she doesn't know where the kids are. So he told her to just stay where she is and she's gonna come and help her. So she was on high dose of Topamax. So it can cause you sometimes to wear my keys and will end up with some cognitive problems. So it's not good medication for teachers or professors at Columbia University or, you know. So, but you can order to policemen or to others, not to firemen, okay? So valproic acid is a good medication, it's very effective, but fortunately it can cause hair loss, weight gain, and tremors, you know, it's a lot of side effects. Propranolol is good if patient has anxiety, like, you know, stage anxiety and all those things, because it's good for anxiety generally, or tremors. And it's very effective medication. However, unfortunately, it gives reduced energy sometimes, and very feared for men side effects, which is impotence, and postural symptoms, and some problems with it. If patient has asthma, you know, they're contraindicated usually. Flumazenil, which is not available in the U.S., unfortunately not available, can give some weight gain and some Parkinsonian symptoms. We use verapamil, which is actually, paradoxically, has not been shown to be that effective in randomized control studies. There are very few poor studies, but we use it a lot for migraine prevention anyway. And amitriptyline can cause drowsiness, you know, dryness in the patient's mouth, urinary retention, weight gain, but very effective medications. And if they have problems with the sleep, you can actually give these medications at bedtime. It improves their sleep. And they have the comorbid depression. It can help. It's not a good antidepressant because, you know, the dosages we use are very small for its antidepressive effects. Just like we use in neuropathy, basically, right? But it's effective for migraines, definitely. And Effexor has also been used for migraine prevention. It has been shown to be effective in randomized controlled trials. These drugs are not available in the United States. Metoserchide. It's called erythropoietin fibrosis. It's been taken off the market here. But you can still order it from Canada or other European countries. For example, France has still, and Denmark can buy it as well. It's a very strong anti-serotonin agent and actually very effective for migraines, but you can't prescribe it. And lisinopril and ketoconazole I talked about, major side effects of cough. And now we also use some alternative therapies for migraine. And one of them is vitamin B2, riboflavin, coenzyme Q10, butterbur, which is a plant, and this German company which provides this medication and approved in Germany by their FDA, and feverfew. And some medication you can even buy with combination of magnesium and feverfew and riboflavin, like Microleaf. Now, other treatments is Botox injections, nerve blocks, physical therapy, biofeedback, intravenous infusions we do for our patients. Outpatient or inpatient. Again, there's a very except for Botox, there is very limited evidence for others, given that there are no randomized control studies. But we still use the treatments because we are desperate. When patients come and nothing helps, we want to try like different approaches, you know, when they treat them. And it's always good with the psychiatrist and biofeedback and relaxation, because a lot of patients are actually depressed. And this is a study from Botox, and you see it's effective. It's been shown to be effective and better than placebo. Although, even though there is no reduction in the number of days, a major reduction in the number of days, this is from two studies, randomized control studies, but we see there's a change in the number of hours, cumulative of hours, and it helps. I mean, I inject it to patients, and they'll tell you there is some difference. I mean, they feel it's sometimes they'll say the decreased number of days with a headache. Sometimes they'll say the severity of headache has been decreasing. And of course, it's helping also with the cosmetic changes. And this is the pharmacotherapy of tension type headache. You see, the treatments are not used here. We use primarily analgesic non-steroidals or combination analgesics, and amitriptyline is a drug of choice for tension-type headache. You can use nortriptyline or mirtazapine, which is Remeron, recently shown to be effective, which is an old slide, but Botox has been shown actually not to be effective in chronic tension-type headache. Now, for cluster headache, we also divide in abortive and preventive measures, and here the drug of choice is sumatriptan injections. It's simply safe patients with cluster headaches, and has been shown to be effective better than placebo. You see 74% in 50 minutes have reduction of pain, and the pain-free in 10 minutes, 36 against 3%. Oxygen has been used, but it's very difficult to use. You can use it in the ER, if the patient's in the ER, give the oxygen. Some people even get like oxygen tanks, you know, but it's kind of complicated. But it has been shown to be effective. And actually, there is only a recent study which has been randomized and controlled and published in headache. But it's but we'll be always using that because of it's been effective. This is actually a very nice slide showing the most effective abortive treatment for cluster headaches, sumatriptan oxygen. You can use migraine nasal spray or in injections as well. And they're here. Zomig or zolmitriptan nasal spray has been shown to be effective as well. So my choice is I give the patients Imitrex injections. If they don't respond or they don't like it, they don't like injections, I give them nasal sprays of Zomig. And then the others you can do if you want. I mean, if you know, it's options. Now, if they come to your office and they started having their cluster headache attacks like, you know, because it comes in the seasons. What I usually do is I start them on prophylaxis, which is verapamil, is the drug of choice for these patients, but I also give them steroids to kind of overlap with verapamil to help the verapamil, because it takes some time for verapamil to work. So what I do is I give them Imitrex injections, I give them steroids and verapamil. I send them home and I get an EKG, because EKG is needed for when the patient's on verapamil. You look at the PR intervals. So you get an initial visit EKG, and then you check 1 and 2 weeks if you do the increase of the dose. And then you can do every 3 months. Now when you talk about primary and secondary headache disorders, it's very important if you see the first time the patient, you know, even in the pain field, like, you know, you guys call pain management, right? But you get patients sometimes with the headaches which are not being actually fully diagnosed, or and you actually are there like a headache specialist for them. So then you need to always think about secondary etiologies. If you're in an emergency room doing consult for the pain patients, make sure that they have been ruled out for the symptoms, because if you start treating them for migraine and they have some secondary causes, because we know that tumors, meningiomas, or some other tumors, aneurysms can mimic migraine. People can have purely like migraine-like headache. So one of the very important is cerebral venous thrombosis. Do you know which condition predisposes patients for cerebral venous thrombosis?
Pregnancy
is one of them, right? It's always we get the consults and we have to rule it out. Exactly, protrombotic states, you know, pro-inflammatory states, you know, obese individuals, for example, can be at risk because of pro-inflammatory state. So which one?
Sicklers.
Yeah, sicklers too, exactly, yeah. Or the patient, for example, birth control pills. I mean, it happens. So acute stroke rarely gives you the headache, but it's there. Primarily hemorrhagic because of the pressure of the hemorrhage. Mass lesions, of course, AVMs, abscesses, tumors. Pseudotumor cerebri is an epidemic in U.S. You know, always, when you see patients with a headache, always do fundoscopic exam. Even if you don't see anything, just document that you didn't see anything. And if you're not sure, send the patients to ophthalmologist to evaluate to look at the discs. But if you see the disc and they're sharp, they document that they're sharp, and then you know that. Because it's actually a higher prevalence. And pregnancy is one of the factors, risk factors, obesity, and treatments with vitamin A, like, you know, for the skin conditions, is a risk factor. And pituitary apoplexy is another one, which is also a risk factor during the pregnancy. It's, yes.
Is vitamin A a risk factor for?
Pseudotumor cerebri.
Yeah,
it can be very dramatic, and they can lose vision and everything with this. So you need to make sure that if they have pituitary adenoma, you know, they can bleed sometimes, and they can get this pituitary apoplexy. Meningitis, you know, it's, you know, nuclear rigidity and fevers, you know, all the meningitic signs, right? Acute cluster glaucoma can be sometimes like migraines, or sometimes cluster headache can present, or trigeminal autonomic cephalalgias. We had a patient who had paroxysmal hemicrania, like picture, like, you know, cluster headache like picture, and she was seen by like all neurologists in Montefiore, you know, by attendings and everything. And at that time, I did fellowship, so I know about this condition. So I told the patient, I sent her to ophthalmologist, and she was found to have an acute cluster glaucoma. And we had a whole lecture on this afterwards. And temporal arteritis, if the patients are over 60, you know, always palpate the arteries, see if there's a pulsation, if there's induration, you know, check ESR, CRP to make sure you don't have that. Cranio-cervical artery dissection. Do you know what is usually the cause of this? I mean, which scenario usually patients can present? Exactly. Chiropractor is like a red flag right here. Exactly. Or if like they do some gardening, you know, if they hyperextend their neck or something, sports, something. Usually younger people, you know. Or patients with Marfan syndrome, for example, they're also predisposed to dissection. So you need to make sure that there's all this. Or this is, you know, very rare conditions, you know. Ehlers-Danlos syndrome, for example. Hypertensive encephalopathy, yes, it's always. Encephalitis and SAH, you know, these are. And medication abuse headaches, that's why Dr. Portner actually disagrees with me on this, but studies have shown both observational and epidemiologic that patients using the abortive medications on 15 or 10 days more a month, they are at increased risk for medication overuse. Basically, a chronic daily headache with the features of migraine, and it shows that prophylactic agents and acute therapies are not effective. You can give them anything. Like our patient from yesterday, I told her, I'm not going to be able to treat you unless you stop overusing the medication. She takes triptans every day, and I told her, you have to stop it. That's it. And this has been challenged by recent studies with Topamax and Botox, where they have shown you can still give the prophylactic therapy. However, it's still tricky. You can't really rely on the studies 100%. And other red flags, you know, there's a lot of red flags, snoops and all these things, you know, mnemonics. But the major thing is, like, if you have a patient who presents to your office who never had headaches in their life before, it's an indication for imaging study. If there is some change in the pattern of the headache, it's also an indication for imaging study. If the headaches are becoming refractory to treatments, and if they are not responding to any of the previous treatments, or you give them something, they're not helping, it could be a tumor or something, you know, in the brain. So you need to be sure that you rule it out. You can have a migraine headache for all your life and develop a tumor and have exacerbation of a migraine and think you have just a regular chronic daily headache. So just rule it out. What time is it now? Is it 30? Okay, so we're done. Do you have any questions or?